Look along the path here. This is a great place for salamanders right here. They're usually pretty, this is kind of a time of year when they're not so easy to find, but let's see, they love this this water.
There's got to be a lot of life in here. This is...
Oh yeah, here's one here. There's a number of different species of salamanders in this particular region with slightly different coloration in each case. Notice that this guy's living in a coloration that matches him.
Yeah.
And they tend to, all the different color variations tend to move to rocks where they just blend right in. He's looking at you there. Say hi. Wave. But notice, you know, there we go. This place is teeming with life. You've got obviously the water, and it's because of the water that there's more diversity of life than you would normally see. But you've got the algae that's growing in the water, the slimy stuff.
Right.
You've got inside the water, you will find, we can't see it, but there will be all sorts of bacteria. There will be microorganisms that are eating the bacteria. You've got these leaves that have fallen down into this area from the trees. And you have within the leaves, you've got fungi that's, the fungi are specially designed to take that material of the plants to break it down and leave, not only have enough for them to eat, but again, in that mutualistic sense, they put nutrients back into the water, which become nutrients for other plants. So you've got plants here. You've got animals here, the little salamander. You've got bacteria. You've got algae. You've got protozoa. You've got the full disparity of life. The big differences among organisms are all displayed here. And then there's so much that is invisible that you can't see. So much more. In fact, thousands of times more. The estimate is that if you took all of the plants and all of the animals that are on the surface that you can see and put them on a scale, that the bacteria that you cannot see in the upper few meters of the soil would outweigh all of the plants and animals you can actually see.
Well, that's hard to get your mind around.
In fact, in geology, we're beginning to realize as we dig down into deeper and deeper cores, we're finding bacteria a kilometer, 2 kilometers, miles beneath the surface with increasing concentrations as we go down, not decreasing, which you might expect. So we're beginning to think that there's a biomass or total mass of living organisms even greater a mile down than there is on the surface. So this world is just full of life. Again, that picture of God. God is a God of life.
Mm-hmm.
And he puts life into the creation, and he puts it at every place. It's floating in the atmosphere. It's obviously growing on the surface, living on the surface, but it's also deep underneath the surface. You find it in glaciers, in ice. You find it in the bottoms of the oceans, the middle of the oceans, the top of the oceans. There's no place on Earth where you don't find living organisms.
Find them inside ourselves and
inside
all around
us. Inside ourselves, outside of ourselves, inside the rocks, outside the rocks, everywhere. And so God has created life in such a way that this creation that we can see drips with life as a picture of the God of life. Mm-hmm. He wants us to see life, but his life is invisible. We can't see it, but he wants us to understand it. So I believe he's created illustrations of his nature. He's put life into physical organisms that we can see, so we have some sense of what life is, and then he's filled the creation with it, so we see life all about us. And then all those attributes of God, he wishes to show the relationship among the members of the Godhead, the mutualism that exists there, where each member of the Godhead loves and interacts with each other member of the Godhead. Mm-hmm. So he puts mutualism in among these organisms. So we have organisms here that are working together to develop this community of organisms. You see it just here in a few square feet, but it's a picture of what is true across this planet. Mm-hmm. And here's kind of cool. In places that are very difficult for life to exist, like a desert, a glacier, you would think there'd be no life. There is life. But there, it's even more important that the organisms that live there work together to live in that difficult environment. Yeah. And so, again, that's a picture of how we're supposed to live as human beings. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
When times are tough, we're supposed to be working in more mutualism to go through, not just survive, but to thrive in those situations and to show, illustrate the very nature of God to the world. We're supposed to do that in our lives as God has created this creation to do.
The whole notion of relationships are sourced in the very nature of God, who has been in relationship for all eternity. And it looks like he's built a whole creation filled with these vital divine relationships.
And we're only scratching the surface on understanding these things. We've only just begun to understand those, how many of those relationships there are. We know there's many more. You know, there's plenty of room for people to do more work. We've got, there's much about these individual local communities we don't understand. And the more we learn about it, the more we learn about God, the more exciting it is. There's plenty of room. Some people say, well, they used to say back in the 19th century, you know, science has figured everything out. We don't have anything else to learn. Perhaps there's a student who feels that way. But that is not true. This creation is huge. God created this creation enormous enough that we will spend eternity studying it, still learning about him, being drawn closer to him throughout eternity. It's easy to understand in one sense, but there's so much of it. It's so deep, it's everywhere, that he's going to keep us busy. By the millions, he can keep us busy for all ages because he's an infinite God.
So there's still a frontier there, isn't there?
Absolutely. Every place you look, there's a frontier of the small, frontier of the large. There's all sorts of places we have not yet been.
So this is what excites you about science, isn't it?
It's part of what excites me. I mean, I don't understand how people can't get excited. Well, I guess it's the way I've been designed, but this is incredible. This is beautiful. There's so much here going on that maybe that's part of what excites me. People see one thing and I see so much more. There's so much, and that's what science is. You see one thing, but the scientist digs in and sees something that no one else has seen before. It's a frontier.
That's right.
If you want to look at it that way. People like to climb mountains because people haven't climbed mountains. Well, science is a place to go and look inside or behind or around things that haven't been seen before to actually see things that haven't been seen.
It seems like the deeper we go in space or the deeper we go into all of the things around us, that we find these amazing systems and mutualisms that you're talking about.
And it's so, there's so much more. There's so much more to be found here. So look at this little guy. We've got, don't want to hurt him. Got a little caterpillar here. Oh, I got him dirty. There we go, got to pet him. So we got a caterpillar here. What an amazing thing God has created with that, the process we call indirect development, where an organism, when it is birthed or hatched out of an egg, looks extremely different than its adult form. Seems to go through two different life forms. Like in this case, you've got something that looks like it is a caterpillar for a certain part of its life, eats a certain type of food for the duration of that, and then goes into a cocoon and comes out as a completely different kind of organism, a butterfly or a moth. And during that process, it's in that pupa. The easy way to do this, you would think, is just to grow wings and legs and this sort of thing. Take the legs that already exist. There are three legs there, or six legs. So you'd think you'd just grow the legs out, grow the antenna out from where the... But no, it appears all of the tissue of this thing really, it seems to dissolve, and the cells restructure themselves into a completely different kind of organism. In fact, if you saw them, separately...
He took a dive here.
I think he's all right.
Okay.
If you looked at them separately, you would think they're actually different species of organisms, instead of two different stages. There are some organisms that go through three stages. There are some plants that go through three different stages, looking radically different in each stage, so that the entire life cycle cycles through multiple very different looking stages. It's incredible design, a beautiful, perhaps even a little bit of a picture of how he wishes to transform us. We don't look so pretty before we come to know him. And he's able to take that broken life and make a spectacular, beautiful life out of it in his time and in his way.
This is what Paul was talking about, that that when we then are transformed, that will be like a seed that becomes something different, So there's a deep transformation there.
An acorn doesn't look much
That's
like
exactly
an oak.
That's exactly right.
Well, that, it's funny, I that acorn is alive. There's a little baby oak tree in there. Mm-hmm. Doesn't look at all like an oak tree. It's an embryonic oak tree that looks very different from the from what it's going to grow into. It's like having two different organisms, two different stages of life. And again, the transformation. He wants a transformation from the seed, doesn't look anything like an oak, to the mighty oak. Mm-hmm. Is there a difference between the two? In one sense, no. It's an oak from the moment it's originated as a seed all the way through its adult form. Humans are the same way. We are fully human from the moment of conception all the way through life, because God sees us for who we are, not what we do. We're not human because of we can worship God. We are not human because we can do something for God's benefit. We are human because of who we are. And we are given those abilities because of who we are and because of how He loves us. We are not given humanity or assign value because we can do something for God. He didn't need anything. Mm-hmm. We have value because of who we are, which means that baby in the womb has value for who it is as a human being, just as much as a productive person of society, just as much as a person dying on a hospital bed, fully human all the way through, because God values humanity for who we are.
It's one of those deep questions, is why does God care about man? What is man that thou art
what
mindful
of? What is man that thou art mindful of him in Psalm right. 8? Thou hast made him a little lower than the angels and has crowned him with glory and put all things under his feet. He's made us rulers of the universe. He's the one that deserves to be ruler of the universe. He's the one that created all those things. He's the one who merits the rulership. But he created it knowing, intending to pass the rulership off to these things. He said, let us make man after our likeness in our image and let them have dominion. He passed it off to us. We don't deserve it.
Yeah.
We weren't chosen because we were the smartest. We weren't, because we're often not. We weren't chosen.
Often not.
We weren't chosen because we're the only ones that had the ability. We were chosen because He designated us rulers. Mm-hmm. And it's an awesome opportunity. And it's part of what being a scientist is, actually, to understand the creation enough to properly rule over it. If we're rulers, we're supposed to take care of those things we're ruling over. We're supposed to serve those things that we're ruling over. How do we take care of something we don't understand? I tell the story about the caterpillar here we had. If a child finds a caterpillar, and they always go through this. It's like, oh, look, a caterpillar. And they come in to mom and dad and say, hi, caterpillar, can I keep it? Can I keep it? And of course, you know, okay, now how do we keep it? What do we feed it? Well, if you don't know what a caterpillar sure. needs to eat, mm-hmm. it's very likely you're not going to give it the right thing, and it's going to die.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't understand those things that you rule over, you're likely to hurt it, even if you don't mean to.
Mm-hmm.
Science is a means of better understanding our creation, so that God's creation, so that we can serve Him by meeting the needs of that creation. And that's another fascinating application of science. In order for us to be rulers, we've got to do science to understand those things that are made.
It's like the farmer. If he doesn't understand wheat or corn or sorghum or whatever it is that he's growing, he's probably not going to make a very good farmer.
That's right. That's right.
So we need to understand more about the creation around us to fulfill our role.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.